AM Radio Now, episode 131. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4IQ. And we, and by we, I mean the entire world, is in the middle of preparations for the World Radio Conference of 2015. So it's coming up next year. Our little slice of the world, ham radio, is interested because we have the possibility of a band on 60 meters, not just the five discrete channels that we've got right now. Other countries around the world have channels on 60 meters. Cuba has just given their hams a actual band, a small one, but an actual band. It doesn't overlap any of the channels that we've got. So there's some work to do on 60 meters, and we're going to find out more about that and the preparations for it in just a minute. But first, I do need, since we're done with the Kickstarter for Tapper and all that, I need to point out my buddy Arvin back there is interested in having you help out with Ham Radio Now. So if you like the programs that we're doing, if you're finding them useful and you want to contribute to us keeping on going and doing them, please stop by hamradionow.tv, our website. Click on Arvin and you can make a contribution. And thank you very much. Those of you who have done that, appreciate it a whole lot. Those of you that haven't done it yet, now's your chance. All right, so 60 meters, the WRC 2015. Stuff is coming up. Let's find out more about that. On my Skype line is Brennan Price, N4QX, right?
That's correct.
And you are the ARRL Chief Technology Officer.
I am.
So thank you for coming back on Ham Radio Now. Did we ever figure out what Chief Technology Officer was?
It's simply the title for my job, because the bylaws require the league to have one, and with good reason. It is not a position where I am responsible for the website or day-to-day IT operations. However, we are responsible for trying to stay abreast of the various technological developments, not only within amateur radio, but within telecom in general. And the professional staff here in Fairfax, Virginia, John Siverling, WB3ERA, and myself are charged with knowing what's going on in that space and trying to advocate for amateur radio in technical and regulatory environments, both within the United States and around the world.
Okay, and you are the ARRL's man in Washington, or one of the guys in Washington.
I am one of the guys in Washington. We've got several. John Siverling and I concentrate on international conference preparations, and there's a significant amount of domestic work that goes into that as well. We also have our general counsel, who Chris Imlay, W3KD, who's in private practice in Silver Spring, Maryland, but spends a great deal of his time working on behalf of the league at a ridiculously discounted rate.
So he's sort of a part-timer in terms of doing the legal stuff.
He is a contractor, yes.
Okay. What's the difference between what you do and what Dan Henderson does up at headquarters? He's got regulatory in his title, too.
Dan Henderson does a variety of tasks relating to regulatory information and special projects that come across his desk. And I actually used to backstop that type of work during my first tenure with ARRL when my title was Field and Regulatory Correspondent. That was almost 14 years ago now that I took that job, which makes me feel ridiculously old. Dan has been doing that work since John Hennessy's unfortunate death back a few years ago, I believe in 2006 or so.
So but Dan is the guy, if a member's got a question about regulations in the FCC, Dan is the guy to go to, not you, right?
That's correct. Although we are listed in the phone directory in Fairfax, Virginia, and if a member calls, I will answer and I will talk to you, because we will always talk to a member. Yeah.
And that's why I'm talking to you today, because there's some FCC stuff going on. This appeared on the ARRL website maybe today, maybe yesterday. Let me get my cursor over here. This is, and you're not getting my video very well, so I'll tell you what I'm looking at.
I can see what you're looking at, and I can actually open it on my screen as well. So we're looking at the same thing.
Yeah, this is the one that says FCC opens brief window of comments on WRC 2015 draft recommendations. And that's what I wanted to talk to you about. How long is this window open, first of all?
Well, comments are due February 18th for folks who are interested in filing. And frankly, this docket doesn't really generate a whole lot of comments because most views are reflected and fairly vigorously so within the discussions that we have during the WRC 15 Advisory Committee. And this committee is charged with the task of coming up with common private sector positions on the agenda for the 2015 World Radio Communication Conference.
Yeah, so I feel like we need to take a step backwards and sort of get a little bit of a bird's eye view of what we're talking about. In 2015, the World Radio Conference is going to happen. And I talked to Larry Price. He's not your dad, right?
He is not. He and I are not related in any way that we know of. Now, we do both come from the same part of the country and share the same last name. So I suspect if we both dug hard enough, we might find some type of kinship. But we didn't know each other before I became a ham and started working for ARRL.
Okay. Well, I talked to Larry last summer at the Huntsville Ham Fest, and we got started on this WRC 15 deal with our eye focused on 60 meters and the idea that that it's one of the little bitty things at WRC 15, which, you know, it's a worldwide everything in communications conference, will be the possibility of a ham radio 60 meter band. And a band rather than the five discrete frequencies that we've got now. There's a few other things going on there, but have I got that correct?
There are a variety of things on the agenda for WRC 15, but the potential of an allocation to the amateur service on a secondary basis at 60 meters is on the agenda. It is an agenda that is numbered using a convention that's a little bit difficult to describe. It's the fourth item on the agenda, 1.4.
All right. So. And as Larry was describing it, and as the episode had him in was titled "Hooray for Cuba," because it was the Cuban delegation that has made this proposal.
The Cuban delegation did make the proposal, and on behalf of a very active radio amateur community in Cuba, and the worldwide amateur community was certainly grateful for that. And there was enough interest in the proposal to get it on the agenda for 2015. There was a move to limit the number of items that would be on the agenda in 2015 because there's also a very big issue on allocating new spectrum to the mobile service or considering new allocations to the mobile service for mobile broadband applications and something called IMT. And IMT is essentially ITU speak for smartphones and various mobile broadband devices. So that is taking up a great deal of the energy in preparation. But even though that is considered one of the biggest deals, amateur radio did make the cut. And for the fourth conference in a row right now, we have a potential allocation under consideration.
Okay, so that issue it doesn't have anything to do with 60 meters. It's just kind of sucking up all the air in the room.
It is sucking up a lot of air, but it is not sucking up all the air. And there's a very aggressive agenda dealing with not only broadband issues, but a wide variety of regulatory issues and other spectrum allocation issues, and including the definition of coordinated universal time, which I was very surprised the ITU had anything to do with when I first heard of this issue, but it actually is a somewhat big deal, and it's on the agenda.
Interesting, because I just put up an episode from a guy from the Tapper Digital Communications Conference, who is a self-described time nut. And he was saying in his talk, it was the banquet talk at the WRC, he was saying that coordinated universal time is actually an amalgam of some 300 some clocks around the world. It's all mushed together to find one. I don't know if it's an average or what it would be.
It is much more complex than my ability to describe. But the debate is actually focusing on whether to retain the leap second in the time scale, because for a number of telecommunication systems, the addition of a leap second on a regular basis causes a fair amount of trouble. And the debate is whether that trouble is worth keeping UTC close to some type of geophysical observation. I've can see both sides of the issue. ARRL really isn't taking an aggressive position on either side because it's frankly not one of the things that's on top of our list.
All right. So a lot is going to be going on at the WRC. It's ham radio gets a tiny little piece of it, but a tiny little piece.
Well, everything gets at least a tiny little piece, and it's something we're paying very close attention to, and we have to, because for each agenda item that we're enthusiastically in favor of an affirmative resolution, there may be several more where we have some concerns. So it's not just 60 meters. It's a number of things that we're paying attention to.
All right, but in terms of 60 meters, Cuba got a resolution on a 60-meter band. And so what's happening now? The FCC wants to hear from the FCC has got a big – let me see if I can bring that up. Got their proceeding here someplace. Okay, yeah, the FCC has a huge proceeding – or a publication talking about what they've got going on at WRC, covering everything. But that little bit about ham radio is going to be part of that. What do they want to hear from hams? Are we ratifying what Cuba has proposed, or are we trying to come up with something different or our own ideas? What is it that we want to tell the FCC if we decide to make comments on this?
Well, the scope of the proceeding that's open right now and that has a comment date of February 18th is to gauge any public input on the output of the WRC 15 Advisory Committee, which is a committee on which I serve and in which both John Siverling and I participate in the informal working groups. This committee has approved a draft proposal to fulfill WRC 15 Agenda Item 1.4 by making a secondary allocation between 5275 and 5450 kilohertz. So essentially, the advisory committee is saying, hey, we see nothing wrong with a big band here. And in fact, having this amount of spectrum would facilitate our obligation not to interfere with primary service users because it gives us some place to move. So we're asking for something pretty substantial at this point, and we're pleased that we were able to get consensus among the private sector interests in the United States for this position. But that's not the end of the story. After the FCC invites comments, it'll be forwarded to the NTIA, the federal side regulator, who will have something to say. I suppose we've made a persuasive enough case where maybe they'll agree to it. Realistically, I suspect that they may offer some resistance or come up with a counterproposal. And then we have to work things out.
This WRC working group that has their draft of it so far. Who are they? Who's in that?
The advisory committee is comprised of a number of individuals representing various private sector interests. It is formed under the Federal Advisory Committee Act. One person per organization is allowed to serve in the committee, although multiple people per organization are permitted to serve at the informal working group level. I am a member of the committee representing the interests of ARRL. There are a number of other committee members. The roster is actually available on the advisory committee website, which is one link down from the International Bureau website, fcc.gov/IB. And then if you look at WRC15, it will take you to the committee's website. The committee membership is wide and varied, and all of them have a varying interests. And it's our job to try to negotiate some type of consensus proposal on each of the agenda items. Sometimes it's easy, sometimes it's not.
It sounds like NTIA is not part of that group.
NTIA is not part of that group. They are usually do attend the meetings as observers in order to present any parallel proposals that may have come up in their side of the process. But they do not get a voice. And sometimes if somebody on the federal side is a little bit insisted that something might happen one way, it's not uncommon. It's not terribly common, but it has happened in the past where somebody will speak up and say, excuse me, what private sector interest are you representing here? And the answer is none. That being said, we can't ignore government interests forever. And this is simply how the process works. The federal side has their own procedure, and they come up with proposals. The private sector has its own other procedure, which is conducted in a more open manner, and proposals come out of that. And that's where we're at right now. A proposal has come out of the private sector side, and where the FCC is soliciting comments on that proposal before it sends it over to the federal side.
Now, the NTIA is important in this discussion because, at least for 60 meters, that's really their spectrum. They're the folks that are pretty much in charge of that.
It is absolutely their spectrum, and it is their interests and needs are going to absolutely be taken into account in whatever the final product is. It was the view of the advisory committee that a wide allocation was something that was doable and would actually help achieve the goals of non-interference. And it's actually a little bit more than a goal. It's a requirement when you're talking about a secondary allocation. But the NTIA may have different ideas, and I'm sure that they will express those ideas in due time. And
I'm sure they will.
There'll be a reconciliation process, and we'll go forward with whatever comes out of that.
The folks in this in the working group, now this is a private industry working group, I'm starting to understand. Do any of them have an interest in 60 meters specifically?
I'm the only member of the advisory committee that is representing an organization of radio amateurs. I am not the only radio amateur who is a member of that committee. However, the other radio amateurs who participate are representing other professional interests. They work for other people.
But Verizon, Verizon, CBS, and that long list of folks that you were afraid you left somebody out of, none of those want a piece of 60 meters.
There are some private sector, non-federal assignments within the band that we're talking about. And I know of one that has been made to another organization, which is represented on the committee. That being said, we went through the hoops, and they don't seem to have the concerns that I expect will be forthcoming from the federal side shortly.
Okay. So when do we find out what NTIA wants? And we've got to go through this FCC process and comments and stuff like that. And then how does it finally get to the point where NTIA can weigh in?
If I held up a piece of paper to the camera, would this be a good video? Let's try this
out. I think I can see that.
Okay. This is I'm trying to get it all on the screen. Okay. This is the a simplified process by which let me come over this one.
So I don't want to see the complicated one. That's the simplified one.
The complicated one, I'm sorry, I'm trying to, okay, the complicated one has two paths to this diamond that I'm pointing at. This is the simplified process by which a proposal becomes gets to the WRC and gets acted upon. And there are two parallel paths to that diamond that I just pointed at that's in the center of the chart. There is the WRC 15 advisory committee process, in which private sector and state and local government interests participate. And then there is the radio conference subcommittee of the IRAC, which is a long form for where the federal interests go. And, even though the WRC 15 advisory committee meetings are open to the public, and they get published via public notice on the FCC website, and have teleconference information provided. And anybody who wants to listen in can call in, or for the main committee meetings, watch on the website. That doesn't exist on the NTIA side. That process is closed, folks in the private sector don't get to see what's going on until something comes out of the box. Nothing has come out of the box yet. I expect that something will be. Maybe something is in the works right now. I don't know. I do know that when we did get our domestic allocation, the channelization versus band question was addressed. They weren't willing to address that at that time. Perhaps that will change, perhaps not. They also weren't willing to go beyond five channels at that time. Perhaps it'll change, perhaps not. We'll have to see. We think we've laid out a pretty good argument for at least a band, and preferably a somewhat wide one in the proposal, which is under discussion now.
All right. What I'm thinking of here, I guess to take us off track just a little bit, you know, sort of a tangent, is in terms of whether we get a band or whether we get channels, we've been looking now at a lot of other countries establishing 60 meter, most of them channels. Cuba has an actual little band, which doesn't cover any of the channels that we have.
That's correct.
Other countries have their own groups of channels. Lots of other countries have their own groups of channels. And a few of them are, I guess, what they call harmonized, where they're the same. But a lot of them have discrete channels that that other countries don't have. And, of course, being HF, RF, it does not respect borders. So... And I know that arguments of logic don't necessarily work with government. Sometimes don't work at all. I'm looking for a reaction here. You can smile. So arguments of logic don't necessarily work. But if this band is now being littered with ham signals up and down the band, it starts to look like maybe a band is something that was de facto working whether the NTIA doesn't like the idea or not?
Well, one of the things that we're going to have to address if we are to have an affirmative outcome at WRC 15, and an affirmative outcome is by no means assured. We could talk about where some of the opposition is coming from in a moment. One of the challenges is going to be negotiating where within the segment under consideration the allocation should be and how large it should be. The radio amateur community, in my view, should be very grateful to any administration that permits its amateurs to experiment on 60 meters and show that this is something that can be done. We're very grateful that Canada recently came on board and authorized, actually, what appears to be the same five channels as are allowed in the United States. But you're right, it does vary from place to place, and Cuba has taken its own approach, and that's an approach that is a little bit different than the United States approach. Whether or not it's something that would be workable here is something we're going to have to discuss. Obviously, ARRL is of the view that a band is workable here, but we'll have to have those discussions with our federal colleagues at the appropriate time. If we get far enough down the road to an allocation, reconciling the various national approaches is going to be difficult. And one of the things that has concerned me and is in the back of my mind is that the result of WRC 15 might actually be worse than what hams in some countries enjoy. And whether or not that's a good thing might depend on where you live. So this is something that we're thinking about. The solution isn't easy, but, you know, it is in the meantime, we've got a number of countries that are saying, yes, this is something we're going to look at. So these are favorable developments, and we're grateful that it's happening. And we'll deal with the challenge of reconciling these things down the road. And
that reconciliation, that is what will happen at the actual WRC, or does it happen sometime before that?
I can't imagine that it will happen, that there will be a venue in which people can really discuss that until the conference happens.
Okay, and that conference is next year. What part of next year is that going to be? It's all been set.
Be in November of next year. I believe the dates are November 2nd through 27th in Geneva. So November in Geneva, which I'm used to now.
All right, if I recall my conversation with Larry Price, the WRCs don't have to be in Geneva.
They don't have to be in Geneva. In fact, they do try to encourage administrations or member states to host WRCs periodically, and there has been one in Istanbul in the relatively recent past. That being said, the default location is Geneva, and nobody seems to be interested in bidding for the conference, which includes footing the bill for the venue and so forth. So, with people not willing to do that, it will be in Geneva.
Okay. So to briefly summarize the I'm not sure I can briefly summarize this. The FCC is giving us an opportunity to comment on anything within their proposal. Within that, for hams, is this 60-meter band. So we say we like it. We say we don't. ARRL, I assume, is going to take a position on that.
We are going to file comments, and we generally do in this proceeding. And it's an ongoing proceeding where proposals get approved in batches after a full committee meeting and then get circulated for comment. We generally file comments in order to make sure that some amateur radio issues that may not be on the top of the commission's minds are adequately explained. The general approach seems to, among most committee members, seems to be to have have their say at the committee and not file comments. My philosophy tends to be it's always best to go with suspenders and belt.
Well, yeah, I mean, we want to make sure what's in the FCC's input to the next step, which I guess is reconciliation with the NTIA and other federal agencies.
It is reconciliation with the NTIA if the NTIA has come up with a proposal, which they have not as of this taping. If they so the next step is probably going to be sending the FCC WAC proposal over to the government side process. And I can show you on this chart where that is. You see where it says start right above my finger?
Yeah.
Well, the finger, that's where it is yep. on the government side. So there are a lot of steps to go. And we'll this is just one tiny part in the process. That being said, the thing about this process is we have to be vigilant at every step, at least the steps that we're permitted to observe, to try to promote the best possible outcome whenever we can, and not just on the 60-meter item, but on various items where we might not like what's going on. We need to be prepared at each step in order to try to make sure the outcome is as close to what we would like as possible.
Is the government side a pure veto if they don't like what's going on, or is the actually a negotiation somewhere, and who finally makes up their mind?
It is not a pure veto. There are negotiations that can go on, and generally speaking, folks at the level of at the high level of the NTIA and FCC, who hammer these things out, work really hard to try to come to a consensus position. And usually nobody is perfectly happy with what comes out, but it is the process by which the United States advances proposals to regional and world conferences. So you know, sometimes the output is a little bit closer to what one side suggests than the other. Sometimes there's widespread agreement on, and there's no negotiation at all. It's you just take a document and run with it. So the output varies on a case-by-case basis, and it's our job to try to get as good an output as we can.
Who has the final say? What part of our government is actually carrying this stuff to Geneva? Is it the State Department?
The State Department actually carries these things to international meetings because the State Department is responsible for representation at UN specialized agencies and OAS groups such as CTEL. I would say that the role of the State Department is less often that of referee than it is of consensus builder. They try really hard to focus the discussions between the two regulators, the FCC and the NTIA, and drive things toward consensus. They do have the capability of making a call if one needs to be made. That being said, I think that they really try to avoid that, if at all possible. This whole process, from beginning to end, is really consensus-driven. I know that we occasionally...
That doesn't sound at all like our government these days.
Well,
at the top level of Congress and stuff, that doesn't sound like it. We don't really see very much of the parts of government that work, do we?
Well, this is a unique process, and it doesn't always work. If we look at the package of things that came out of the advisory committee, you can see a significant divide between the broadcasting community and the mobile community about the use of 470 to 694 or 98 megahertz, depending on where you are in the world, for mobile broadband applications. And the amateur issue was actually discussed at the same group as that issue. And the discussions were long and tiring. And despite an effort to come to consensus, they just didn't. So they ended up advancing two views. So it doesn't always work, but it often works. And this is certainly been a learning process for me in the, I guess it's been a little bit more than 5 years I've been on this job right now. They certainly don't teach you this in law school.
So we're at a fairly early stage, although I guess a lot of work has gone into getting to the point we're at right now.
We are at a fairly early stage, but we're getting to the point where a lot of things are going to happen very quickly. We have less than 2 years to go before the conference convenes. Once the United States comes up with a proposal, it goes to the regional meeting of CTEL, the regional telecommunication body for the Americas. And there is a procedure by which that may or may not become an inter-American proposal if it is backed by a certain number of countries in this hemisphere and not opposed by a certain number of countries in the hemisphere. And the ratio is somewhat complex, and the rules could glaze your eyes over and make you fall asleep. So I won't try to repeat them here. John Siverling, WB3ERA, covers our CTEL activities for us and does a tremendous job. He is very fluent, not only linguistically in Spanish, but culturally in what's important with telecoms in the Americas and really around the world. So he's uniquely suited to that assignment, and we're very pleased to have him. And that's where it will go after it gets out of the United States.
All right. So you're not expecting a lot of hams to want to make comments on this, sounds like. Not one of the big things that hams get all worked up about.
It is not something where there are traditionally a mass of comments. And we certainly wouldn't discourage any radio amateur from commenting on whatever proceeding he or she wanted to. We would ask that... any comments that are filed try to focus on the scope of the proposal under consideration and its merits. There are a great number of issues affecting amateur radio, but beyond this narrow allocation issue, I'm not sure that the commission would find comments in this proceeding helpful. They may in another proceeding. So if anyone wants to file comments, February 18th is the deadline. Absolutely go for it. And if to the extent that they're willing to take my advice, please do focus on the narrow issues that affect amateur radio that are in the package of proposals.
Now, the actual procedures for being able to do that, you can find links here in this story on the ARRL website on how to go about doing it. I remember filing comments many, many years ago before the internet, you know, multiple copies and a very formal, rigid procedure for, you know, how things, everything had to look. And if you didn't do that, we were led to believe that you would be ignored. It's a lot easier these days.
It is easier these days, although the public notice does call for a few steps that aren't ordinarily taken. This is not a traditional APA rulemaking type of deal. The procedures under the Federal Advisory Committee Act are a little bit less formal because it is at its core an advisory committee. We are here to provide advice to the commission, and at the end of the day, they can take it or they cannot. It's their call. The docket number is 04286. One can file comments via the electronic comment filing system. I would encourage folks who want to do so to take a look at the public notice of January 28th because there are some fairly specific instructions with respect to where these should go. Specifically, a copy is requested to be sent to the commission's duplicating contractor, best copy and printing. They have a website there, and on that website you can find their email, which is something you can send it to. And they also ask that a copy be sent to Alexander Roydlott, who is the assistant chief of the Strategic Analysis and Negotiations Division of the International Bureau. And Alex is essentially the chief person being advised and the chief FCC negotiator with NTIA.
So that is considerably different than the average just file comments on the online.
It
is. You've got more to do.
Yeah, you got a little bit more to do, and so
and they're not looking at the ECFS to go look at your comments. You got to send them to them.
I suspect that they are looking to the ECFS as well, but as I said, it's always better to go with suspenders and belt. I'm not going to test ARRL's comments by failing to take one of the steps on here.
All right. So, but you no longer have to set things up in the very formal process with all the semicolons and the in the matter ofs and all that. Rigid formal language and presentation style. You can just say what you want to say.
Some people take that approach. Some people put it in a more formal pleading style. I'll be taking a crack at the first draft of this and sending it over to Chris Imlay for format. Adding before the league or the league's executive committee approves filing, so we're going to formalize it up. But you know, you do have the capability of being a little bit less formal. The commission
from comments that I've seen, a lot less formal. I mean, just a couple of paragraphs, plain paragraphs. You type into their website, and you're done.
That is one way to do it. I would caution about being too informal and might suggest something or suggest that a comment that was little more than me too might be best left unfiled. But that once again, that's up to each individual ham.
Well, what kind of advice would you have for someone who wants their comments taken seriously? Now, you said stick to the topic this time. Do they need to give some of their background to sort of qualify themselves for being able to make comments like this? Should they just give a fairly specific, pointed, reasoned argument, but not bother with here's who I am and here's who I've been for the past 40 years?
I would suggest that the argument is more persuasive than any appeal to authority or citation of credentials. Obviously, any radio amateur is going to have an interest here, and any radio amateur of who has some experience on HF is going to have some relevant operational experience. That doesn't need to be spelled out. The commission knows what radio amateurs are capable of and is appreciative of that. I would really encourage folks to simply read the proposals, consider how they address the items on the agenda, that to which they're responsive, and make suggestions as to how they're good, how they can be improved, or why they're good. Narrower focused comments are better than broad sweeping comments.
Yep. Have you talked to FCC staffers about sort of in general comments that they've read from hams on various proposals and rulemakings over the past few years? Do you get a feeling what kinds of things impress them and what kinds of things they just kind of toss?
Specialty is the international side of things. In proceedings beyond the International Bureau, Chris Imlay really leads our effort and is our main face in those bureaus. So I've not had the opportunity to speak on with folks about things that might be filed in other proceedings. I'm simply my advice is really narrowly tailored to the instant proceeding because it's. The WRC has a fairly narrow agenda, and it would really be best to concentrate whatever comments we have such that they're responsive to that agenda. There's a place for almost every type of argument, but I wouldn't want someone to make an argument that spectrum be allocated, say, at some place other than 5.25 to 5.45 megahertz in this proceeding that's before the International Bureau right now, because it'll just be looked at and they'll say, oh, that's nice, but we don't have anything on the agenda for that. So thank you.
So you would look at this as if you want to say something, support the proposal as it stands and give some of the reasons that you think it will be a good idea to do this as opposed to come up with something all brand new, because we've kind of already done that.
We would certainly welcome support, although far be it for me to tell every radio amateur in the United States how he or she should think on this issue. We believe that the committee has come forward with a proposal that is workable and merits support. It does not include the entire 200 kilohertz that is under consideration, and some folks have asked me about why that is. And that's simply because the bottom 25 kilohertz was allocated for HF oceanographic radio location applications at the last WRC. I have tried to operate on top over an HF oceanographic radar that found its way into an amateur band about 14 years ago. It's impossible to do. We're very pleased that a solution was found for HF oceanographic radar at last conference because the oceanographers and climate scientists, folks at NOAA who work in this field, do really great stuff with it. It is really top-notch work, but it's impossible to operate over. So we view giving that segment up as a win.
Okay, so we're talking about still not quite 200 kilohertz then for a ham band.
We're proposing 175.
Okay.
That doesn't mean we're going to get 175. As a matter of fact, I would be very pleasantly surprised and turning back flips if we get 175. As a matter of fact, Gary, I'll go on record and say, if we get 175, I will come to your studio. You can videotape me turning a backflip. I'll actually have to learn how to turn a backflip, but we'll work on that.
Got a lot of expensive equipment here in the studio, and we may want to shoot this outside in the driveway.
I'll do my best to dodge it.
So I don't know how fast we can handle this, but I want to take a step back in time. When I came up to visit you and discuss the results of WRC 2012, where the headlines were new ham band. I think I even accused you of bringing us back a new ham band at the 472 kilohertz range. Brennan, where's the ham band?
We've petitioned for it domestically. It was actually mentioned as part of the implementation proceeding for WRC 07, which didn't commence until after the conclusion of WRC 12.
For the folks that aren't as wonky as you and I are.
As me, yes.
We should probably specify that WRC 12 did not more than recommend. I mean, their proceedings said here's a ham band 472 to 479.
Yep.
Yeah, a very small ham band, but a ham band in that area. They said this is it. This is settled, done international regulations.
Things are never settled or done because you always need national implementation. And national implementation happens on the national regulator's schedule. Yep. It is before the commission. It has been petitioned for. We have also sought the 135.7 to 137.8 segment, which was dealt with at WRC 07, the conference before, in which we've had some difficulties with various utility groups. In the past, it has been petitioned for at the appropriate stages of the process. We will make supportive input, and if arguments need to be responded to, we will do so. The thing about any domestic rulemaking proceeding, aside from the International Bureau Advisory Committee process, which we just talked about, there's a pretty defined timeline by which things have to happen if they're going to happen. There's no such timeline on a traditional Administrative Procedures Act proceeding, which is what this is. The regulator is going to act when it is going to act, and it is impossible to predict when the regulator is going to act until the regulator acts. I wish I had a better answer for you.
Let me see if I can gin up some controversy, because if I'm recalling correctly from my conversation with your dad last summer, with Larry Price, W4RA, the president emeritus of the ARRL and IARU.
In case you're joining in the middle of this, he is not my dad.
Yeah. I believe that when I asked him about this, his comment was, don't hold your breath.
I would suggest that holding that comment was, I won't say exactly spot on. I think we've made a very good case to have an allocation someday. But in terms of holding your breath for it to happen within any particular period of time, yes, that's spot on guidance.
Well, the impression that I got was he was saying that there's folks who don't like this. They don't want it, and they've got enough juice that we're not going to get it.
There are some folks who didn't particularly like this, but among those who were represented on the international scale, I think we've addressed their arguments, and those on the domestic side are essentially the same utility folks who had expressed opposition at 135.7 to 137.8, and their case at 472 to 479, frankly, is not nearly as strong. They don't have as much stuff up there, and they don't have a compelling case for not moving it if we are really a problem to them, which we ought not to be. Is there more work to do? Yes, there may be more work to do. I am optimistic, but it is certainly not going to happen anytime soon. Please QRX. That's all I can say.
Yeah. So the deal is, try to put a bow on it. WRC and all the international stuff said, yes, there can be an international ham band in this spectrum. Each individual national government then has to implement their own regulations. Has anybody else done it? Has anybody made a ham band down there yet?
a number of countries have, I'm sorry, I don't have the list off the top of my head, but there are periodic authorizations, and there is operation going on at the 630 meter band now. And we refer to it as 630 meters instead of 600, because 600 corresponds to exactly 500 kilohertz, which if you think we're getting opposition at 470,
that's a third rail issue.
it most certainly was. And I frankly didn't expect it to be a third rail issue. Boy, did I learn my lesson. So.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's old. It's the old maritime distress frequency. They're not using it for that anymore, but I guess somebody still thinks they ought to hang on to it for a while.
They would like to implement a new system that essentially is a higher data rate NAVTEX type of operation in that spectrum. And there are folks who are working on the development of that. I don't know how long it will take for it to come to fruition, if it ever does come to fruition. I will say that folks who opposed amateurs going on 500 kilohertz on the grounds that that should be a maritime Morse frequency forever are going to be profoundly disappointed because it will not be used for maritime Morse.
But we can't get those guys a channel on Sirius XM satellite or something? Move them up where everybody else is going for reliable international communications?
MF and HF still have their utility. And that is something that, excuse me, I need to decline a call right now.
All right.
Somebody else coming in.
That might be what caused your...
yes, I see.
Caused your picture to freeze. You are rock solid here. Not too bad a frozen image. So you are live again here. I guess it was the call interruption that froze you up.
In addition to being Chief Technology Officer of the American Radio Relay League, I am the treasurer of the Virginia Chess Federation.
Well, that's more important.
I had somebody who needed some money, and they kind of needed it right away, so I said yes.
Okay. So we don't have time to do justice to this story. Let's give it a little bit of lip service. This is the ARRL files comments on the symbol rate petition. And now that's all done now, right? The comments and reply comment period is over, or are we still in reply comments for that?
That docket is closed at this point. The reply comment deadline was January 7th, 2014.
Okay. So if anybody is still got their undies in a bun, they're too late.
No, they're not too late because it is a petition for rulemaking. If the commission agrees to go forward with something, they'll propose something, whether on our initiative or on their own initiative, and then there'll be a notice and comment period at that point as well.
Okay, so that wasn't a notice of proposed rulemaking. It was somebody asked us for this. What do y'all think?
Yes, it was a petition for rulemaking, which went out for public comment.
Yeah, and it was the ARRL that filed the petition.
It was.
Yep. So what is it you're asking for? I don't know if we can condense this down into something we can talk about in a couple of minutes. This is like a whole other show. But if we were to try to condense it, what is it you're asking for?
Well, the rules governing of what data rates are permitted, not only on at HF, but also at other bands, have been regulated since the rule's inception by symbol rate, which is the rate at which one binary system flips essentially between a mark and space. At HF, the symbol rate for a binary system is limited to 300 300
baud, I think is what they call it.
300 baud, yes. Why am I saying kilohertz? It's 300 baud. And that reflects technology that is as old as I am at age 43. And we don't feel that it is really conducive to promoting the advancement of the radio art, which is one of the things that we as radio amateurs are charged to do. That being said, if we simply removed the symbol rate without replacing it with anything, not only could slow data modes be permitted, but data modes of unlimited bandwidth could be permitted. And other services seem to coalesce around 3 kilohertz channels with maximum occupied bandwidth of 2.8 kilohertz as something that works for them. And that's what we've proposed as a replacement. Right now, it is perfectly legal to have a data signal that occupies an entire data subband, so long as each binary system within that signal is sufficiently inefficient and has a symbol rate of less than 300 hertz.
Yeah, I don't think that's something most hams understand, that there is no bandwidth limit right now, just how fast you can shove stuff through.
There is a for a single binary system in frequency shift keying, which is does not describe the universe of data modes that are in use in the amateur service. There is a mark space separation limitation. There is a bandwidth limitation on our 60 meter channels that is more a function of the fact that they're channels rather than a traditional band. That said, in our view, a significant improvement in the amateur's ability to advance the radio art with experimentation with modes that are both existent and in use in other services and which may be developed sometime.
The ARRL was very careful to say this is not a rehash of something that occurred in the mid-2000s, the regulation by bandwidth, which was proposed and then fairly quickly retracted when it proved to be pretty unpopular with ARRL members. What's the difference?
Well, the regulation, the proposal from the mid-2000s sought to put wideband modes with other wideband modes, narrowband modes with other narrowband modes, and would essentially put some of the wider data signals up into what is now the phone band. I wasn't on staff of the league at that point. I was between my two tenures, but it was my understanding, looking from the outside in, that didn't go over too well. I would draw a distinction between if we want to call what was tried in the mid-2000s regulation by bandwidth, where you're taking modes and putting them together based on their necessary bandwidth. I would suggest at any rate that the approach we're taking is not truly regulation by bandwidth, rather regulation of a particular bandwidth. We want to replace an antiquated limitation which limits the efficiency of data modes and replace it with something that doesn't exist right now in order to ensure that experimentations with higher data rates are conducted within a chunk of spectrum that is manageable.
Yeah, there's something I really want to bite my tongue and not get into very deeply, but I'm having a hard time controlling myself, and that is that we are we're talking about 2.8 kilohertz across the board on our HF bands in I guess traditionally the quote CW parts of the band and the phone parts of the band, but we're still making a distinction about what we can put into that 2.5 kilohertz worth of deedle, 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 deedle. Am I correct? In one part of the band, you can put some kind of stuff in it, and in other parts of the band, you can put other kinds of stuff in it, even though if you tuned it in on an analog receiver, it's still just hash.
That's not quite what we're doing. We're not suggesting that that data be permitted in the phone bands. And some folks had asked early on, is this going to affect digital voice? No, absolutely not. Digital voice is voice that belongs in the phone band. I would take a little bit of issue with an assertion that CW bands exist. CW
CW is everywhere. It's our universal mode.
essentially everywhere, only in the center of the 60 meter channels, but that's the exception rather than the rule. We do, however, have data subbands, and we're not suggesting the data be allowed anywhere other than the data subbands. Data is permitted throughout the entirety of a data subband now. It really only starts to fill a significant portion of it during major operating events, but there's no regulatory restriction now to data occupying everything from the bottom of a particular band up through where a band becomes a phone. And we're not proposing any changes there. And to suggest that we are, I think is inaccurate. It's not there are certain places data can go now. Data will still be permitted to go in the same places. We're just suggesting that those transmissions be permitted to be much more efficient and be limited in the bandwidth that they occupy. I would emphasize right now that an emission can occupy the entirety of a data subband as long as each binary unit is sufficiently inefficient.
So the folks that are worried about this are, at least they've got a little bone to catch from narrowing things down. And no one's doing that. No one's using the whole band for their inefficient data mode, but they could.
They could.
So that's the worry.
And I think as I understand some of the concerns that have been raised, they vary. I do think that a significant number of concerns may come from Morse and more traditional data mode operators, particularly narrowband data modes, who may be concerned about a change to the status quo. In my personal operating time, I almost exclusively operate CW and narrowband digital modes. This is radio teletype, PSK31. I've just started on JT65. It's very good for a weak station such as mine. I am from that community. I have to believe that if there are an experimentation, which caused the bands to be a little bit more occupied, it's difficult for me to see that it can't be accommodated. If it can't be accommodated on the fly, certainly there are band planning procedures by which digital modes attempt to coexist now, and they're usually somewhat successful. And in cases that couldn't be addressed by this, it's usually due to somebody behaving in a manner that is not consistent with good amateur practice or is outright contradictory to other rules in the amateur rules that we're not proposing to change, such as the rules for unattended operations.
I believe in the vernacular, we're talking about a butthead.
In any population of 717,000 some odd folks, you're bound to have people who would meet the description that you suggest. Fortunately, it's a very small minority, and it's been years since I've encountered such individuals on the air. So I think that's a testament to the capability of our enforcement program, and I'm confident that if folks weren't able to behave under any rules that govern digital operation, a case could be made against the operation that didn't quite measure up to snuff. And, the commission would take a look at that and in due course.
One last question about this, and this, just to educate myself, how do we parse the difference between data that originated between me typing on my keyboard or however else we're going to send something that looks kind of like text, and me talking into a microphone. Both of them get turned into something that is essentially frequency shift keying or phase shift keying. How do we parse the difference between those two?
Well, we parse the difference between them as the regulations permit. Speaking into a microphone is such that it comes out as audio on the other end is by any reasonable application of the commission's definition of phone, it is phone. There's just no way around it.
Well, there's a way around it because back in the day of regulation by bandwidth, it was like, we don't care. Whatever signal fits in this amount of spectrum, that's what goes in this part of the band. And whatever fits in this smaller amount of spectrum, that's what goes in that part of the band. So at that point, it was ignored. And I think perhaps that was what got that proposal in so much trouble.
It didn't seem to go over very well from my perspective on the outside looking in, which is one of the reasons why we tried something different this time. Folks didn't want to segregate modes by necessary bandwidth. The argument was made in favor. I think that argument has its merits, but it clearly didn't fly with the amateur population, and we didn't think it would fly again in the same form. We get that. Nevertheless, we need to try something else in order to get rid of a proposal that is objectively backward, or not a proposal, a restriction that is objectively backwards. Nobody at the international stage has yet come up to me and said, we can't give more spectrum to radio amateurs because they have an artificial limit on the efficiency of their data communications. Of course, that would only be true in the United States. I'm not sure of any other country in the world that has a similar baud symbol rate limitation. But it was chosen because it was state of the art when the rules were drafted decades ago. It frankly, in my view, makes us look technologically backward. And it is not something that, as chief technology officer of the league, I can say we can support continuing. We'll look forward to the continuation of the discussion here. And we do know that change to status quo is scary. That said, the status quo is technologically backward and it deserves to be changed.
Okay, so we have a request for rulemaking. It's been commented. It's been reply commented. It is in the hands of the FCC, which may or may not make a notice of proposed rulemaking. If they do, it may or may not look like what the request was.
The commission will act if and when it deems fit to act. And it is impossible to determine when that's going to be until it happens.
All right. And that is all a subject for another show, a whole show, and we'll talk about that as soon as we can. Brennan Price, Chief Technology Officer for the ARRL up in the Washington, D.C. area.
I'm in Fairfax, Virginia, where it's going to be above 40 degrees for the first time in several days today. And I'm looking forward to that.
Say hi to the president for me next time you see him.
If I see President Obama anywhere while walking the streets of D.C., I'll say hi.
You don't have lunch every couple of weeks?
He stopped taking my calls for some reason. I'm not sure exactly why.
All right. Thank you very much.
Oh, well. Take care, Gary.
And that will be it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Thank you again, Brennan. Once again, Arvin back there overseeing all of the proceedings and hoping that you'll stop by the website, hamradionow.tv, click on his icon and make a contribution to keep us going here with all this fancy television equipment and my time. I want to go to McDonald's and get a Happy Meal. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73, everybody, over and out.